Hello, YouTube. Clydesight here, wearing my wonderful Eddie the Cat t-shirt and another wonderful tape recorder video. As you can see behind me here is the collection of tape recorders that appear in the Vintage Tape Recorder Museum. But we're not going to talk about the Vintage Tape Recorder Hall of Fame today. We're going to talk about a new mystery tape recorder. Here comes Clydesight with another one of his very bizarre suitcase devices. What is this? Well, there's actually a clue here. The badge says S-O-N-Y. That means it's a Sony product. What did Sony make? Well, we have the clue, we have the case. Can you solve the mystery? And speaking of mysteries, if you love a good mystery story, have I got a doozy for you. Get yourself on over to Amazon.com and look up The Cross of Ramplett. This is a wonderful mystery adventure story that I wrote with Catherine Garnell, the author of Basil the Bionic Cat. We were able to collaborate and come up with this absolutely wonderful mystery adventure story that takes place in Regency, England. And what's so cool about it is it's all about searching out a secret hidden treasure from the Knights Templar. So if you like Kindle or even Barnes & Noble Nook, get yourself over to Amazon.com or even Barnes & Noble and look up The Cross of Ramplett. It only costs $9.95 and you'll have a wonderful read. So let's find out what is it. To do that, I have to turn this case around and open it up for you.
S-O-N-Y, a Sony stereo demonstration.
So here we have the machine out of its case. Here are the two outboard speakers, here's the manual, here's the microphone, and here's a tape cassette to play in the machine. The machine is kind of awkward to use in this leatherette case because the case is so old and stiff. So let's hook it up and take a listen.
Sony stereo demonstration.
This tape is a recording of an actual Sony stereo demonstration tape that they put out with these machines as well as their reel-to-reel machines. Now, I don't have the original cassette that came with this machine, but I have heard them because I was around when these machines were introduced. This is a recording which I made from the Sony TC530 running at 7.5 inches per second. It's a very, very faithful recording, and you're going to hear it in stereo through the actual computer because the camera mics don't pick up the speakers all that well. We're going to take a close-up look at this machine. I'm going to tell you the history of it, what had to happen to make it come back to life, and how it works. As you can see, the Sony TC126 is a fairly wide machine. It's not shoebox style, it's the lateral style that became very popular alongside the shoebox designs. Historically, I believe this comes from about the 1970s because of the many features that it has. First of all, we've got a fully functional set of controls here for the mechanism or the transport. There's an eject button here, which pops open a door, the cassette slides in. Close it down, you're ready to go. Take it out this way. no spring-loaded mechanism at all. Has rewind, stop, play, fast-forward, record, which you have to press down with the play button, and it has a mechanical pause control. It also has a full auto stop, which is marked right here. It has a 3-digit tape counter here. It has a battery and level meter here. Here in the front we have a balance control, a volume control, and a tone control. And then here we have a stereo headphone output. There's a switch here for stereo or mono, and there's a switch here for normal or CRO2 type of tape. We have inputs for a left microphone remote and a right microphone, and we have two outputs for the outboard speakers that came with the system. They called it the Sony TC126 CS, and I think the reason they called it that was to mean complete system. In addition, we have a stereo microphone that came with it, and the plug is very unique because it has three prongs on it. It has for the right channel, the left channel, and the remote is in the middle. We can see that we have line inputs and line outputs, and we have a speaker monitor switch on or off. Here is the battery compartment, and it takes 4 C-size batteries. When we look on this side, we can see there's an AC power cord, and there's also a switch here for different voltages. Now, when I got this machine, it was in working condition, or so the seller had said, and yes, it did work. The problem was that the head was completely out of alignment, and when I readjusted the head to go into alignment, one of the channels died. When I put it out of alignment, the channel came back. It was very weird. I had to find out what happened. What it turned out was that the wiring to the head either had a cold solder joint or the joint just simply gave out. So I had to re-solder the head. The other thing that it had was, of course, the problem with the belts. It needed all the belts replaced, and there are 5 belts inside this machine. The index counter was not working. The index counter itself needed a cleaning, plus it needed a belt, which comes from the rewind table over here to the index counter. The stereo mono switch that I showed you before was actually broken inside, so I had to take the switch apart and rebuild it, because you can't get a replacement that'll fit that. Not anymore. This is a very unique machine in that it has 2 flywheels. One flywheel works the capstan, the other is what I call a back check flywheel. It operates in the opposite direction. Sony made a big deal about using double flywheels for a while with their tape recorders, and if you've seen any of the Marantz or Sony Professional Studio tape recorders, they usually have 2 flywheels in them also. We're now going to take a look at the inside of the machine, and then we're going to do a test recording. Here we have the battery compartment. Here is the internal speaker that is part of the case. Here we have the mechanical system, and here we can see some of the amplifier board. The amplifier board, of course, runs completely underneath the mechanical system here. You can see the horizontal motor here, and the transformer, and the AC input. Here is where the meter is located. It's on little sponge rubber cushions. The headphone output, the eject button, the function keys, and the pause control. We're looking at the 2 spindles for the cassette, the feed spindle or the supply spindle and the take-up spindle. This is the driver for the take-up spindle when it is in play. Now normally this driver is a much smaller spindle, and the take-up spindle has a rubber tire on it, but Sony decided to use a much larger piece here, and it has the tire, not the take-up table. We can see the brakes here, which is very much like the standard Phillips type of brake, and here is the spring release mechanism for the whole drive system. So first we're going to take a look at it in play. Now you probably saw the spindle moved over
to cause the take-up table to turn. Let me stop it. You see how it goes out of the way? And watch the brakes and this spindle. This is bolted in from the back because of the automatic stop mechanism. But this spindle will come out, and I'm going to remove it so that you can see how the rewind function works. So I'm going to lift it out. I've turned the entire machine completely upside down so you can see the rewind function. As you can see here, here is the flywheel that is for the back check. The idler runs between a flange that is part of the back check flywheel, and it also goes to the rim of the supply table. Now the roller here, the idler here, is mounted on a bar that runs across the entire mechanism. And on the other side of the mechanism there's another roller exactly like this that does the same thing with the take-up table. The idler now is sitting just over here. And now we're going to fast forward. And the fast forward idler, which you cannot see, is doing its job. And you can see the rewind idler has moved out of the way. So if you imagine a bar with two idlers on it, you can get the idea of how this works. We're looking at the upper part of the auto stop mechanism, which consists of two parts. There's a plunger here, which has a flat piece of plastic located here, and then there is the trip lever, which is located here. Now when this lever is pushed forward in this direction, it releases the catch that holds any of the function keys down. Consequently, when the keys return to their normal position, the thing shuts off. This will rock back and forth because of the way the auto stop mechanism runs. And now we'll look at it in fast forward. And you see it goes forward and it touches the plate, the trip plate, but it doesn't go forward enough to actually engage the trip plate. And it's just going to cycle back and forth like that. And as long as this table is the table here, as long as this is not stalled in any way, it'll just continue to operate like that. Now, I'm going to put it in rewind. You can't see anything happening in rewind, but you can see how that's moving. Now watch. Let's look at that again. First it'll touch the plate, then it'll retract, then it will trip the plate. Now obviously in playback, you'll see it cycling. You see how it cycles forward, but it will not trip the plate. However, if I stall this, touches it, it goes back for a second cycle, trips the plate. It's an ingenious system. It's very similar to those banks they used to sell for kids where you put a coin in the slot, turn it on, and a little hand comes in and grabs the coin. The pause control here, which is a complicated mechanism of its own, makes it impossible for this to cycle at all. So I'm going to put it in pause and we'll put it in fast forward. And you can see just inside the slot here, the ratchet lever is going back and forth, but it cannot ratchet to this. Now when I let go of the pause control, it will be able to ratchet. Touches, but does not trip. Well, what the heck, let's trip it. I find this fascinating. I have replaced the supply spindle here and the belt that drives the counter over here so that you can see how that works. Now it has to sort of be fished underneath the lever that controls the eject of the cassette so that the lever can go up and down. So here we go into rewind and you can see the little counter reset it with a push button. And it shut off because of the auto shutoff mechanism. So we know that's a healthy auto shutoff mechanism. Now looking over here, we can actually see the keyboard controls rewind, stop, play, fast forward, and record. And when we put it into play, you can see how the heads move forward. It does have a stereo record playhead and a electric erase head. And it has an interesting clamp here. And that clamp holds the cassette down so it won't pop out. Now if we go over to look at the pause control, how it works, it's very interesting. And it's located here, here, and here, and here. So when we put it into play, watch again, watch this bar here. Now what that is going to do is engage against this little screw, which is a set screw, you can change it, and that's what's going to make the thing pause when you push down the pause button. So we put it into play, and now we start pushing the pause forward, and when we lock it in, you see it moves the pinch roller slightly, just enough so that the tape is no longer engaged, and then it puts it back. Now notice at the same time, instead of applying any kind of a brake to the supply spindle, it disengages the take-up table. So watch again. One of the fun things about this machine is that it is so instructive to look at it. The Sony TC126 is out of its case and is broken down into its two parts, component parts, the amplifier system, located here, and the chassis. There are five screws that hold the chassis to the frame here, and when they're removed, you can swing the chassis over and upside down, but you have to be careful because the wiring to the heads is right here, and it's very tight. The amplifier has 18 transistors on it. It is an AC bias amplifier. The AC bias coil is here and it's covered. There are two record play switches. The machine puts out 1.5 watts of power per channel. The mechanical system is very different from what you would see in a Philips Norelco type machine. Sony basically just simply re-engineered the entire cassette mechanism concept. First thing you'll notice, it has a large motor, but the motor is mounted horizontally instead of in line with the capstan flywheel located here. The second thing you'll notice is that there are two flywheels. That would imply there are two capstans, but that is not the case. In the 70s, Sony had come up with the concept of a backcheck flywheel to keep the speed constant. So this flywheel actually does not have a capstan. It simply sits in a socket and acts as a back check to the capstan flywheel. Now the back check flywheel through a belt runs the clutch mechanism for the take-up table. The supply table is located underneath this little plate here, and the take-up table is located here. The capstan flywheel also has a belt that runs this little pulley. This pulley works the very complicated auto shutoff mechanism that runs through here and then across on all of these little levers to shut the machine off. The auto shutoff mechanism also uses a belt that runs from a pulley on the auto shutoff mechanism to the actual take-up table. So if for any reason the take-up table were to stop, the auto shutoff mechanism would engage and turn off the machine. Thus, this prevents tape jamming or reduces the amount of tape jamming that would happen if for some reason the take-up table was not functioning properly. Let's take a look at this in motion. Now I'm just jumping the power system to the motor. And as you can see, the belt wraps around the capstan flywheel, which in this case is turning clockwise, because of course when it's oriented properly, it turns counterclockwise, which they all do on cassette machines. And you can see that it is running the pulley here that runs the auto shutoff mechanism. The back check flywheel is doing its job of maintaining the motion to the friction clutch mechanism for the take-up table. Let's take a look at it in rewind. And in just a second, this will shut off. You notice that it automatically shut off. The reason is because this was not moving. Now we'll put it in fast forward, and you see that it is moving. And consequently, the auto shutoff mechanism does not auto shut off, because as long as this is turning in either direction, it prevents the auto shutoff mechanism from turning off. Now I'm going to freeze the table as if the tape was jammed. And you see the auto shutoff mechanism went into action. The pause control here is very ingenious. When the machine is in any mode and the pause control is engaged, it moves one piece of the auto shutoff mechanism out of alignment with the others. Consequently, no matter how much it tries to shut off, it won't be able to do so. Not until the pause control is released. So this prevents accidentally auto shutting off while in pause. Now the pause is released and it's in rewind and this is not turning. It shuts off. This is an ingenious system. There is a thrust plate for the capstan and for the back check flywheel, which goes here. We're now going to make a test voice recording with this machine, and then I'm going to play for you some music that I recorded through the line inputs from the TC530 of the Sony stereo demonstration tape. So you can hear how good the stereo is on this machine. It's excellent. We're going to record and play back using just the internal speaker so you can hear that. So here we go. Press down record and play together. The tape is not moving. And now I'm going to start with the microphone. Testing, testing, testing. Testing the Sony TC126 stereo cassette tape recorder built in approximately the 1970s with dual flywheels. This is a test. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is the end of the test. So now I turn off the microphone, and you notice we didn't hear anything from the speaker. And that's because I turned the speaker switch off in the back. If that was on, we'd have gotten howling. Let's hear that play back. Testing, testing, testing. Testing the Sony TC126 stereo cassette tape recorder built in approximately the 1970s with dual flywheels. This is a test. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is the end of the test. Now you're going to see this tape recorder on the bench, but you're going to hear it as playing through the computer.
For those who enjoy the classics, here is a classic Japanese composition played by the Leon Pops Orchestra, featuring the Koto. Thank you.
Thank you for watching this presentation by clydesight about the Sony TC126 stereo cassette quarter with automatic shutoff and dual flywheels. It's a very, very nice machine. It is not exactly user-friendly when it comes to servicing it, but I did get a copy of the service manual, which was put out by Sony themselves, to explain how to get into the machine and fix it, and that was very helpful because I never would have figured it out otherwise. So service manuals can be very useful. Hope you enjoyed the video. Don't forget The Cross of Ramplett, a great mystery story, just as this was a great mystery tape recorder until I got it all fixed. And when you figure out all the mysteries in Cross of Ramplett, you will feel just as great a sense of accomplishment as I did when I restored this machine. Bye-bye, YouTube.
SONY, a Sony stereo demonstration.